Hello everybody and welcome to the Touring Pro Series Audi Sport TT Cup. I'm Jake Sanson, beside me is Robert Wiesenbühler, and we have some absolutely fantastic racing from some of the top Touring Pro Series drivers on the planet. Lots of great action from round one here at the Nürburgring, and there is an awful lot of drivers on this grid who want to start the season on a high.
I'm really looking forward to this. This is going to be really exciting. First race of the season, the first race ever in the Touring Pro Series with these Audi TT Cup cars. And yeah, it will be a big challenge for the drivers.
And what a location to start from as well. The Nürburgring in Germany. It is the mecca of motorsport in its very true sense of the word. It is an incredible place to start the season. And there's a lot riding on this, Robert. I mean, you've driven these cars before. You've driven on this circuit before. You know that coming into the box, I mean, we saw in the pre-practice sessions, 31 drivers covered by half a second. And there was a good, you know, a couple of hundred drivers trying to get on the grid for this one. This really is incredibly difficult to predict.
Yeah, well, I just drove 1.5 weeks ago in the TC1 series on this track on the Nürburgring. And in the qualifying session, we had like 15 cars within 3/10 or so. So it was crazy how close the times were. And I expect nothing less in these Audi TTs here. And the pre-qualifying that already showed that, you know, the drivers are equally close in this series. And it was actually Giorgio Mangano, a completely new driver to the Touring Pro Series, who took the top spot in the pre-qualifying with the 103.6. Pre-qualifying was held on Sandford, so it was not held on this track, but we can expect something similar here.
It is incredible as well when you consider the kind of quality of driver that we have here. I mean, there is so little to choose between the drivers, and this is one of those environments where if you make a single error on one lap, it's going to be the difference, certainly in qualifying, between the front row of the grid and the 14th row of the grid. It really is that high pressure.
Yeah, exactly, especially because you only have 5 minutes time to set a lap time. And that's a lot of pressure on the shoulders of each single driver here. And it's very easy to make a mistake in the qualifying session. And so I'm really looking forward to it. I don't think we'll see one driver dominating here. I think it will be very, very close.
Unpredictability, exactly what we love about professional motor racing. I have to say, I am looking forward to this from the pure perspective of the fact that this is a one-make championship with so many incredibly talented racing drivers on the grid with very little to choose between them. And it's quite appropriate, really, that it's the Audi Sport TT Cup, as I'm about to hop on a plane in less than 24 hours' time to fly out to a place where Audi are hoping to take their 14th win in the space of the last the space of the entire millennium we're living in, which of course is the Le Mans 24 Hours. So Audi is obviously synonymous with the world of motor racing. It's an incredibly tough environment to be racing in, but it's also an incredibly friendly one to be racing in. Audi has always primed itself, Rob, for being a manufacturer that is as much about its passion for motorsport as it is about its deliverance for technology. They're a very passionate bunch of people.
Yeah, and what you shouldn't forget is that these people who are racing here tonight, if they win this championship, they will have the opportunity to drive this exact car, the Audi TT Cup, in real life and have a test drive sponsored by Audi. And they will also be able to drive an Audi R8. So Audi is really bringing that passion to the online races as well. So it's a really good opportunity for all these drivers.
Well, qualifying, 5 minutes on the clock, please. And we're about to go racing for the first time in the 2016 season. The qualifying times have tucked down, and we are now starting to get underway for the first full session of the season. Niklas Laubisch is the man who is the first one to gung-ho for glory. We ride on board with him as he goes through the first few corners of this lap. It's the shorter configuration this as well, Rob. That means it's going to be very tough for the drivers to get a good lap in quickly.
Yeah, well, actually, I think it helps a little bit that it's a short configuration, because you might be able to do a little bit more lap times in the short qualifying session. So this is not a super pole. You can do as many laps as you can. But of course, you still need to nail it. You see Laubisch exiting the Mercedes Arena. And now you will see the corner, the new corner of the layout, so to say. Yeah, here it is, the Kurzanbindung. And back again on the regular Grand Prix circuit.
Yeah, so we're riding, looking back from what Niklas Laubisch will see in his rearview mirrors from on the top of the roof. And this is a really difficult test for the driver. You've got to be straight on the ball, right off the gas. You really don't have much of an opportunity here with only 5 minutes of qualifying, and one of those has already gone, by the way. You really do have to nail the lap straight on the mark. You haven't really got much of an opportunity for error. And as a driver in this environment, in yourself in the past, Rob, I mean, you've won TBS titles in the past, you know of how much pressure there is. What's going through the driver's mind at this point when you're trying to nail it all together for that perfect lap?
I think it's the best case scenario is when you're not thinking of anything, when you're just doing your laps, do what you have practiced, and just bring it onto the track. And yeah, we can see the first times coming in now. It's actually Garibaldi with a 27.9 taking provisional pole position. He's a driver that we know, of course, from the TC1, from several leagues that he's raced in the past. And that's a very nice time as well. And it seems like he's done it right. He didn't think about the pressure too much.
Yeah, initially he had a 0.2 second advantage there, but straight away we now have Alexander Dunedin, who has popped up just 0.068 of a second off the pace. So already those times are coming down pretty quickly. Klaus Schulze in third position with Etienne Bruns in fourth for the moment. Then it's Butcher, Mangano, Leitner and Platsk. So it's a really competitive top eight already. 0.6 of a second separating the field. That's not necessarily unusual for the first session. It's never going to be as close as it was in the free practice sessions that we saw building up to this. But the drivers who have qualified, they know how closely matched they are. So it's all about getting a great lap in early.
Yeah, and it's not over yet. We can see we're on board with Toccacelli right now, and he's at least green in the first sector. So this means he will improve on his personal best time. And I think we will see the gaps getting closer and closer in this session, and then also as the sessions move on. I mean, a 27 on his first lap, that's quite a statement from Baldi.
Really is, and he's the first person to duck under, what is it now? That's 1 minute 28 seconds for the lap. He's managed to get into the 127s pretty early on in the session, which is going to be a tough ask for anybody to duplicate. Alexander Dunedin, he's on a quicker lap though. Look at that, he was already gone purple in the first sector. What's he going to do on this lap? He needs to keep the energy up as he comes through that flat-out right-hand kink. Maybe a slight feather of the throttle as he comes through, but nothing too out of control, and he's already
a tenth of a second up.
That's impressive, especially this early on.
Yeah, that looks like a great lap time. And we can see Baldi and Dunedin, two of the main protagonists of the TC1, being added here again, fighting for the pole position in the very first race. Let's see what he can do.
Oh, right.
And he lost the time.
Yeah,
no,
he didn't. Well, okay.
He's actually on pole.
He is there.
That was confusing.
It was a little bit, to be fair. But yeah, Dunedin does get the pole there. 127.884. And that's by a tenth of a second. That's a big margin. With only a minute to go in the session, that is a big statement. There's Niklas Laubisch. He was the first one, really, to put a lap time in. And he's looking for just at the top 20 at the moment. He really needs to find a little bit extra. And he has found that. So he's improving by about half a second. That is going to be a big leap for Laubisch. He's about 20th at the moment. But on this kind of pace, he's looking at around 8th, 9th, 10th maybe at the worst if he gets this final sector nailed. So out of the final turn down the straight, Nicholas Laubisch is looking for a strong 128 here over the line. And what is it? A 128.8. That's very much better. So he's there or thereabouts. But wow, look at that. 0.9 seconds off. He lost a lot of time again in that final sector. It's amazing how the pressure is getting to drivers in that final sector. That's where they're losing a bit of time. Certainly that's where Laubisch lost it. Here's Alcio Jr. finishing off his run. And I don't think it's going to be a major change of positions that we're going to see. But interestingly, after a very interesting start to the Audi Sport TT Cup, it's first blood to Dornedin, Rob. Is that a surprise?
No, for me it's not a surprise. And also for most of the drivers that I talked to, it's not a surprise either. And we're going straight into the race, so no cooldown time for the drivers. And Dornedin and Baldi, now they can really prove it. Now it really matters.
So the drivers are indeed lined up on the starting grid. 20 minutes of racing in the Audi Sport TT Cup. Here's what Baldi sees as he gets ready for the lights to go out. They are on, and wait for it, folks. Dornedin should get a good start here. Away we go. Good start from Dornedin. What's Brooms going to do on the way to the first corner? Schulze is going to try and slot into position as well, but Baldi's got a good getaway. He's just not quite close enough to Dornedin, even to the braking zone for the first corner. So let's see what they can do as they make their way through for the first time, right round the outside. That's going to be a strong run from Brooms, and they bang doors. Good run there from Bruns. It might just be able to hold this to the inside line, although Giga Baldi is going to do his best to shut the door back, but he has managed to get through into second place. Good driving there from Bruns.
Yeah, great start from Bruns, and he just used the opportunity. He saw it that he could maybe get a better run on the outside and just put the position straight from Baldi. But also great start from Dornedin, who's shot straight into the lead pole position, and now he's already got a small gap.
Well, we're looking at Yannis Baumann, who's having a real tussle on this first lap already. And who is that just in front of him?
That's Chris Butcher.
So Butcher is already showing a big pair of heels up at a seventh position. And he's trying to get on terms with Davide Toccacelli. So already a great start to this race as they feel their way through the chicane for the first time and onto the high-speed section of the course. It's Dornedin from Bruns. Baldi is there in third position, front of Baumgartel, then it's Schulze in fifth from Toccacelli, Baumann, Butcher, now down to eighth position in front of Stange and Mangano, so we're already a really exciting top 10.
Yeah, oh, and that was Baumann very late, and Butcher's going off.
Yeah, Butcher's really made a mess of that, unfortunately. He tried to get a little bit too eager to the inside line, but now they're going
through. Oh no, that's a big crash.
Dear, oh dear, that's not Baumann at all.
How did they save that?
Well, tumbling down the order, Baumann is having a bit of a nightmare now, isn't he? He's suddenly tumbled down the order, outside of the top 10, and this is going to be a great piece of attrition as far as he's concerned. Things not going well at all.
Oh, that's very close, and you could see in the fast chicane that Baumann was diving very, very late into the corner. Then Butcher completely overshot the corner. I couldn't quite see what happened there, and then into the final corner it went all wrong. And they're still at it. You can see it here on board from Chris Hack, from the reigning champion from 2014, when we were using slightly different cars.
Yes, indeed.
Just look at this. Oh, and I think it's Butcher who's going off again.
I think you're right. Yes, he's dropped back into what is now, what, 13th position. He might just be able to hold on in front of Term. But it's a really exciting battle now. That little moment from Baumann has dropped him down to 8th position. Goshkin is now 9th in front of Hack. From Keutler, Leichner and Butcher. Then it's Term, then Plutterman, and then it's David Yundt in 16th position from Visa, Columbia, Platsk and Beck. So it's a really exciting mid-pack, but Dornedin, just look at Dornedin, he's absolutely flying out in front. But that gap that he already started to extend in the first lap, it's already coming down. Bruns is not letting him run away in blind with this one.
Yeah, certainly a great start of the race for the GoSport driver, and he made the most of his pole position. But now we have Etienne Bruns, who's driving for Euronix Gaming, and if you follow the TC1, you know that between Euronix Gaming and GoSport, there's a little bit of tension going on. We had Dornedin and Euronix driver Julian Kunze in the TC1 who were having a couple of really hairy moments on the track. So let's see how this goes here between Bruns and Dornedin. And Bruns certainly looks quick at the moment.
He really does, yeah. Dornedin, Bruns, Baldi, Baumgartel, Schulze and Stange is the order at the moment. It's looking really exciting at this moment in time from the leaders, particularly now that Bruns is trying his best to drop Baldi, and he has done that for the moment. There's about a second between them, so things looking good as far as they're concerned. And if he drops Baldy, well, there's not really much that the man in third position can do about it. It's looking like it's going to be a German totalitarian grudge match on the Nürburgring. It couldn't really be better designed if you planned it. Here's Baumgartl in fifth position. He's trying to get away from Stang. And he's already lost the place, actually, to Klaus Schulze, who's got a good move on him, up into fourth position. So a little bit of an inter-team squabble there, perhaps, Rob.
Yes, these two are teammates, and they are actually running in great positions. I mean, fourth and fifth, that's very impressive. And maybe they should work together, but I'm not sure if they should try to fight that hard, because maybe it's possible that one of them could get onto the podium. And I've talked to Max Baumgartl already, and he seems to have pretty good tire wear. He wasn't that confident in his pace that he could get onto the podium, but his tire wear seemed to be really good. So let's see what he can do.
Well, Dunedin's still holding the pace. He's just clocked a 1:28.781, which is only about a second away from what he managed in qualifying. So the pace is still pretty strong in the early stages here. Brunn is about half a second back still. Jegov Baldy in third position is still about a second away. And up the inside, that's a beautiful little move there as Koshkin loses the place to Yanis Baumann and may lose another to Viktor Koitler. They're door-to-door, banging wheels. This is brilliant scrapping as round the outside, Viktor Koitler, the Brazilian, is trying to come through on Pavel Koshkin. He shuts the door firmly. That's great defensive work there.
Oh, and he's trying to have a look again, but there's no way through. Koshkin keeps the position. Baumann's on the charge. He's been driving really aggressively the opening stages of this race, and he's already back in eighth. Oh, Chris Hack
just got a little bit too close under braking, didn't he? Gave a bit of a love tap there, and we look back from him as well to look back at Chris Hack, who's thinking, come on, Chris, what are you doing? We're trying to go clean motor racing here. I didn't need a shove from you. He's got problems of his own, actually, Chris Hack, because if he looks back, he's got Norbert Leitner breathing down his neck, and he's really starting to swarm now. But this is back, that is how close the gap is. There's nothing in it, Rob. It's so tight.
Oh, and can he make a move here? The next corner is a fourth gear chicane, so it's very dangerous to try a move here. And you can see he's backing out of it. He tries to line up the move for the final corner or the first corner, but just look at this. Look how close it is.
Yeah, Chris Hack is very wise to the maneuver. He knows that if he just crowds Norbert Leitner out, he's not going to give him any space to maneuver. So back in front, it's still Dunedin from Bruns, who's now dropped to about 0.7 seconds back. Down the straight, though, Hacking really having to pull up the wick as he tries to keep Leitner at bay. Yanis Baumann's having a good battle as well. Is this going to be Pavel Koshkin round the outside into the first corner? Koshkin tries the switchback, but he's got problems of his own. Viktor Koitler's caught him up. Very close indeed, Rob. I'm not sure where would be the ultimate place to get the overtaking move when you're in this kind of a scrap.
Well, I think the first corner is the best overtaking opportunity on the track, but you can also try it on the inside in this corner right here, which you just passed, or you could try to dive into the corner that we're coming up to, into the hairpin. So there are a few opportunities where you could try it if you're brave enough.
So is Dunedin going to have this one on a plate, or have we not seen the last of Etienne Bruns? He's still got a bit of a response. Joe Baldy, by the way, is dropping back rapidly in third position. He's now 2.8 off the leader, so it's definite that these two could well have things on their own. Of course, Bruns may just be applying a bit of a karting strategy here, just sitting on the back of Dunedin and allowing him to control the pace of the front of the field and then wait for his opportunity later. It's a great karting strategy. You wait until maybe one or two laps to go and then you make your killer move. And in one make racing, you get the opportunity to think a little bit more like a karting driver. Baldy's still in third position, Schulze in fourth, and it's Baumgartl, Stanger, Mangano, Baumann, Koshkin and Koitler, with Leitner and Hack still having that little scrap, although there is now 0.4 seconds between them. It's Term who's up to 13th, then we've got Pluderman, Junt, Butcher recovering down in 16th place. Platsk is there in 17th from Beck, Visa, and then Laubisch, who's up to 20th position. Good recovery from him after a bit of a hiccup on the first couple of laps. Then it's Barreta. De Veda is in there next. Luciano, Schneider, Wirth, Janaya. And then it's the man whose name I can't replace for Toffee, Rob. You're going to have to help me on this one. I do my best with these names. But I think it's Lucas Riveroni. Am I right in that?
Yeah, I think that's correct.
It's as close as I'm going to get, I think. Colombia there in 28th position. And then Emil Yanenko is there in 29th position as well. It's still about these two at the front, though. Bruns is closing up.
And you can see on the bottom right of your screen, it says PTP, and then there are some lights below that. That's the push to pass. And all the drivers, depending on where they started, they have 15 push to pass available for this race, which will give you 30 extra horsepower. And if you start a bit further back, you have a few more push to pass. But these two drivers will have the same amount. And you can see Etienne Bruns only has 5 push to pass left, so he's not sitting back, he's going all in.
Well, I think it might be a little bit too early in the race to go all in here, because if you look, Dorn Eden, look, he's got 7 left, so I think actually Bruns getting a little bit too eager sat there in second position. Yes, he's right on the boot lid of Dorn Eden, but he needs to focus on the pace of this race. He has managed to get away from Baldi, and that's to his advantage. That's to his credit.
He's close. He's close. I think he might try it.
He is definitely having a think about it. Maybe he's going to try and outfox him around the outside. Dorn Eden moves to cover. That's very smart driving from Alexander Dorn Eden. The pressure is on him at the moment to a certain extent, because he has a lot to lose here if he allows Bruns to control the pace of the race. But from his point of view, he does still have an ace up his sleeve with 2 extra push to passes. And Bruns, well, actually, no, Bruns doesn't have that many more now, because he's used 2 more since the last time we saw him. So he's looking to get into the lead and go up
early. How did he use them so quickly? I cannot really understand how he managed to get rid of all these push to pass already.
Well, he's looking for the inside line. He might get an opportunity. I think he's realized he's running out of opportunities to get past Dorn Eden now, because he probably hasn't got a clue how many push to passes Dorn Eden has left. He's only got 3, so he really needs to be careful when he uses this. Otherwise, he'll get into the lead. He'll have nothing left to defend himself with, and he'll have Dorn Eden in front of him. Basically, Bruns will then become a sitting target, because Dorn Eden will be able to get into the lead and stretch it out. Of course, the other thing as well is that every time Bruns uses a push to pass now, look, Dorn Eden's used one to defend, so the gap has opened up again. This is stalemate.
Yeah, I think if he wants to make this strategy work, he has to get past as soon as possible and then just try to defend even without the push to pass. I think now might be an opportunity, because Dorn Eden used the push to pass on the back straight, I think, so he should not have one available here. So maybe this is a chance for Bruns.
Well, it's all about the battle behind these guys as well. Bruns still there in second position trying to close up. 3 push to passes for him in second position. Baldi is there in third place. The battle further back is starting to heat up a little bit as well, because the teammates, Schulzer and Baumgartel, are still pretty close together, but they have managed at least to stretch out a gap from Mangano, the Italian, in sixth position. Pavel Koshkin is trying to close up on the man in seventh place, Jan Stanger. Then it's Yanis Bauman, Victor Koitler in 10th position from Leitner. Although it was Leitner, now Chris Hacker's got through. And that's how close it's getting in the battle for 9th position. And off the circuit goes Chris Hack. He's just got caught out there in the middle of the gaggle. And unfortunately, one of them had to get spat out. On this occasion, it was the Brit Chris Hack. That's such a big moment.
Yeah, that was very unfortunate for Chris Hack. But it just shows how close the racing here is in the midfield, and everyone's going for every position.
Well, in the second half of the race, he's got 8 minutes left on the clock, and he still has 8 push to passes. So if Chris Hack has timed the strategy right, okay, he has been knocked down to 16th position, as it were, but he may get an opportunity to counteract in the latter stages of this race, especially if the 5 or 6 gentlemen in front of him have used all their push to passes. Newsflash, though, Jens Blüdermann certainly hasn't. He's still got plenty, and that's a great move. Managed to cut across the front of Alexander Thiam. The Frenchman.
Oh,
he's run
and Tam's going off.
Oh dear, Term does indeed run wide there, Rob, and that's a big moment. The 97 coming for it as well. Chris Butcher trying to get his nose in. He's going to try and shut the door very, very carefully there. But that was a little bit too optimistic from the 97 Butcher, and he very nearly let Platz through there. He was being as aggressive as he was defensive, Rob, and it almost caught him out. Now he's going to have a go for the inside line at the hairpin. Can he get this done?
This looks good. Oh, but the blue car breaks far too late.
I don't believe it. Chris Butcher lined him up beautifully for the move, and it's caused absolute pandemonium. Well, I tell you what, Chris is going to be absolutely raving rancid at that one. That was an absolutely infuriating moment from his point of view. And now he's scrapping away with Daniel Beck, the Swedish driver, and the man he was trying to get through in the first place, Jens Plutterman. So Beck is through, up into 15th position. But Chris Butcher will probably be suffering from a very similar syndrome to the man who's now just overtaken him again, Chris Hack, who's up to 13th position. Yeah. The Brits are not having a great day at the office.
Yeah, well, they're both THR drivers. Chris Butcher is the most experienced driver in the whole Touring Pro Series. Chris Hack is the reigning champion, and they're battling with all these newcomers. And I know Chris, and I know he will be raging at this stage. Because
well,
there was really nothing he could have done. He was just hit by, I think it was Platz, but I'm not 100% sure on who it was. And yeah, that's just, as a driver, that's really infuriating when it happens to you.
Well, 6.5 minutes on the clock. Yanis Bauman does not have a push to pass left in his arsenal, so he's really got to be careful here. especially when you consider he's got, what is it, one, two, three cars right on his tail trying to make the play. He's got Koshkin there in ninth position, Koitler, and then Leitner, who we were on board with. This is Pavel Koshkin. No forms of defense in the man's a push to pass here, Yanis. You've just got to hope and pray that Koshkin isn't going to come past. And he's got one push to pass left. Surely there's an opportunity here. Around the outside, they bang doors, they bang wheels. And down to the braking zone, Koshkin is going to try and get the switch back. But on the inside line, Baumann is moving to cover beautifully, and he's not going to let him get through. Now this is the opportunity for the 94 to come on the inside and try and get his own position up there. Victor Koitler, the Brazilian, has he got the move to the inside line? He tucks his nose in, there's contact, and he wobbles mid-corner. Now that's going to open the floodgates for Norbert Leitner to get a switch. This is fantastic battling.
That was great, and you could see how the car got very loose over the curb, Koitler's car, and now Leitner's right on him. And then you can see, you just make one small mistake and immediately you're not the one who's attacking, but you're the one who's defending. And it's a great battle, and Koshkin is doing everything at the moment to get past Baumann.
Well, this championship is delivering to the letter. Koshkin might actually have caught out Baumann there. Yes, Baumann has run a little bit wide, and I think he actually managed to get through up into eighth position there. We're looking at Stanger on board with Giorgio Mangano. Mangano's got no push to pass his left either, so it's going to be pressure, pressure, pressure from Jan Stanger for the rest of this race. Up and over the curbs, desperately trying to find the inside line, and he almost got it. Giorgio Mangano sliding across to the right side of the circuit as if his life depended on it. You are not coming through, Bucko. And Mangano is through there into sixth position, still keeping on in front of Jan Stanger. The gap, by the way, for the leaders, Dorneiden is now over a second clear of Etienne Bruns, so clearly Bruns desperately trying to get some advantage has not worked, and he's actually dropping back. Stanger again has a look at Mangano. He might try and get the switch back here, but Stanger has one push to pass left. Mangano, I believe, doesn't have any, so it's going to be a really exciting battle between these two in the last couple of laps of this race. We've got 4 minutes and 20 or so on the clock. And there's only, I make it by calculation, about three laps to go here, Rob. It's not long left at all.
Yeah, and I first thought that Stanger has a quiet race where he's just moving up the positions, but this does not quite look like a quiet race. And you can see him, he's one of the more experienced drivers, Jan Stanger. But yeah, he certainly can make a move as well. And he's putting a lot of pressure on Giorgio Mangano, the winner of the pre-qualifying. So it's a good battle for a lot of points. And the sixth place in the first race here of this very competitive league, that's something that that you can definitely fight for.
Especially when you consider that I don't think from one weekend to the next the positions are going to remain the same.
Oh, and Davide Torricelli is out of the race.
Yes, you're right.
We completely didn't spot that, but he's been in front of these guys, and maybe it was a disconnect, but we couldn't see it.
Maybe a connection issue, unfortunately, and that's going to put Torricelli out of the reckoning, and that will be very frustrating. You've been there many times before, Rob, when you're in the midst of a race and things are coming your way, it's feeling sweet, and all of a sudden you're out of the race and you don't really get much of a warning. That drop in adrenaline, it must be such a difficult climb down, and the rage must be very difficult to control in that moment.
Yeah, but the good thing is we have a second race, you have the opportunity to redeem yourself, and I just hope that he will be back on the server attack again for the points, because he was certainly had a top 10 pace here.
Well, Dorneiden, he's driven an absolute masterclass of a race, hasn't he, so far? He's got one push to pass left, he doesn't need to use it really until the last lap, because he's got a second in hand here on Etienne Bruns. He's been very mature and very calm. He's put the car in exactly the right position on the racetrack to keep Bruns from coming through. And he's been conservative with those push-to-passes as well. He didn't need to use them all in one go. And he's held on to the pace. It's absolute skittles in the midfield.
Look at that. This is the same battle that we were watching earlier. Now Robert Platz is back in the battle, but we still have Chris Heck in the white car there. Leitner in the black one. In the red car just behind watching everything, and look how they're fighting for position every corner side by side.
It's just intensified another level. This is magnificent. Norbert Leitner and Robert Platz, and they kick up the dust in front, so that's going to cause a little bit of a dynamic change as everybody tries to bring things under control. Even if they are under control, they're going to have one eye on the steering wheel here to try and make sure that they've got everything lined up for the chicane. They're about to go into, well, what time do we have left? I think this is going to be the penultimate lap we're going into, and this is a good move here from Platz up the inside. Can he make the move done on Norbert Leitner? He's going to try, and he's got him. That is a beautiful opportunistic moment there from Robert Platz.
That was really a nice move, and you could see that Leitner was not quite on the line, and then you just couldn't do anything about it anymore. But this is not over yet.
No,
you can
indeed.
Be sure. We see Baumann and Koitler already side by side again into the first corner.
Well, Bauman's going to hold the inside line, but is that going to be enough? It is for the moment, at least, on Victor Koitler. But Koitler, look, he immediately switches to the other side. This is so close. They're practically marrying each other in terms of front and rear bumper at the moment. There's so much contact as they come through.
I think Koitler's through.
Yes, I think he can. Oh! Bauman's going to try and get through as well, is he? Has Bauman got that job done? Yes, he has. So two places lost there from Yannis Bauman. Make that three, because Chris Hack is to his left as well. Nudging inside.
And Leitner on the inside.
This is amazing. Three wide down to
Butcher's
Koitler.
Going in as well.
Oh, Butcher's going to try and go for it. He gets past Hack as well.
He gets two positions.
That's just amazing. Absolutely incredible driving from these four or five drivers. They're still absolutely on it. Give them any chance of a touring car race, and they are going to make it look like one. Is absolutely mega at the moment, and all of that has resulted Yannis Bauman down to 13th position. That's going to make him very sick tomorrow morning.
Yeah, he was in the top 10, and he was just absolutely getting marked in this. In this situation, and it's unfortunate, but that's the racing here. And well, you can see Plavsky and Koitler here, they're not finished yet.
No, indeed.
No! Koitler's off!
Koitler is off the circuit of the chicane. That is a disaster for the Brazilian. Victor Koitler, he hadn't got any push to passes to defend with. It just got a little bit too close in the chicane, and the Brazilian is now down at the back when a top 10 finish was on the cards. He will be so annoyed at that one, and that might well be a conversation for later on.
Dawn Eden has lost the lead.
Yeah, what has happened to Dawn Eden? We're on the last lap here and Dawn Eden has dropped back. Now, has he made a mistake or have his tyres gone off? Because Bruns has managed to get himself into the lead. We didn't see what happened there. We may have to go for a post-race replay on that one. But Bruns is leading. He's running very wide at the hairpin.
Oh, it could be that. It looks like the brakes. He's got massive problems on the brakes.
Yeah, the brakes are wearing or the tyres are wearing, whatever it is. But Dawn Eden has slipped back into third position now. He's trying to get this second position back from Baldi. But Dawn Eden, he obviously had a great strategy, which was to hold station in front of Bruns. But Bruns suddenly realized, you know what? I'm going to be a little bit more conservative. I'll hang back and see what happens. And Dawn Eden, the man with everything to lose in terms of pressure, has dropped back to third position. So it's going to be a steal of a victory for Etienne Bruns. The man who we thought was done and dusted. The man we thought was beaten to the punch. No, sorry, I'm not done yet. Etienne Bruns, he's going to come out of the final hairpin. What a try from him. He stayed hungry. Stay determined, and he's going to get the victory, and he loves it. Etienne Bruns crosses the line. He wins the first race of the season. Absolutely brilliant try from Bruns. Baldi in second place from Baumgartel, who snatches third place from Dawn Eden on the finish line. That is an absolute hash for Alexander Dawn Eden, and so unfortunate as Chris
Look
Hack,
at Chris Hack, he's already back up to 8th.
Yeah, he's going to steal a top 10 finish here. Very nice indeed. He's going to get Mangano on the line by the look of it. Schulze is in 5th position in front of Stanger. Mangano just beats Hack across the line, I think.
I think it was Hack who just beat Plavsk. I'm not entirely sure.
Oh, yes, my apologies. Yeah, they were a good 9 seconds back off Mangano. My apologies. So Hack, yeah, just crosses the line in front of Plavsk. Beck is there in 10th position from Plutterman.
Great Baumann finish for Beck. Out of nowhere. As well, and but I have to say this is such a disaster for Alexander Dawn Eden, and I'm almost certain it's the brakes, because some drivers were talking to me before the race and they were saying the brakes could be a bit problematic at the end of the race if you're pushing really hard, and yeah, it looks like we found our first victim. Alexander Dawn Eden really loses this race at the last lap.
He was the fastest man of the race. He led pretty much every lap of it except the last one. That is astonishing from Alexander Dawn Eden, and such cruel punishment for all that hard work. But it's first blood to Etienne Bruns. He's done an absolutely cracking job to stay in the hunt all the way through. Baldi in second place, and it's a good third position too for Baumgartel. He'll be delighted with that. A podium in the first race of the season, Rob, that always gives you something to smile about going into race two.
Absolutely, and he did not expect that for sure. And so it's a fantastic result for him, fantastic result for the team as well, with Klaus Schulze in fifth place. So good points for the BS Motorsport team. But yeah, what a race that was.
So race one is completed then, and you have to say, a very, very tough race all in all, Rob. I mean, who would you give the driver of the day to in that particular race? Who stood out in particular for you as one we need to keep an eye on in race two?
I would have given it to Alexander Dawn Eden, but without the last lap, of course. What happened there?
Absolutely.
And this is just crazy that this can happen to you. And well, I think all the drivers on the podium drove a really, really good race. Amazing performance from Etienne Bruns, who kept his cool, put a lot of pressure on early on in the race, and then just dropped back a little bit, drove his race safe till the end. Garibaldi as well just takes the point, solid performance. But I have to say, for Max Baumgartel, that's that's one of the drivers that I didn't quite expect to be on the podium pace, and for him to pull it off and then pass Alex as well in the final corner for the podium, that's my driver of the race.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Baumgartl as the driver of the race there for that one. Third position, good performance and good support there from his teammate as well. It's been a really good start to the season. There's your calendar for the remainder of the season. We're leaving Nürburgring after the next couple of races to Zandvoort and then the Hungara Ring. Saxon Ring 2 weeks after that. Spielberg, as it's also known, the Red Bull Ring. And then we finish off on two more of the DTM locations, Norris Ring and the former Grand Prix venue of Hockenheim. It's going to be a really exciting... I was going to say the former home of Hockenheim. It's the only home of the Grand Prix in Formula One now, isn't it, Hockenheim? Nürburgring needs to get back there. But a great start to the season. Really exciting, action-packed motor racing from the Audi Sport TT Cup. And a true indication that we still don't know at this point who is going to be the champion. So there's still more racing to come. And you need to grab yourself a light beverage because it's not going to be long until we're back out there for more. So, welcome back, folks, to the Touring Pro Series TC2 Audi Sport TT Cup from the Nürburgring. We've just recovered from an absolutely spectacular first race. Totally unpredictable, exactly as we were hoping it would be. It all looked like it was going to be about Alexander Dorneydin, but it ended up being Etienne Bruns who took the victory after a cracking opening race, Rob. It's really exciting to see how this season has already thrown a bit of an unpredictability into the works.
Yeah, and I really feel for Alex here, because he just... I mean, we couldn't see what happened to him, but to lose a race on the final lap, that's always, it's always
crueler
heartbreaking.
Than cruel, isn't it?
Yeah.
Crueler than cruel.
But I mean, he's got so many races left to get this win and put himself back into a top position in the championship, and he certainly has the pace, so I wouldn't be surprised if he's if he's going to be attacking hard again already in this qualifying session.
Yeah, it's very true. I mean, we've still got, what is it, 13 races left of the season. This is one of 7 weekends, and therefore we've always got a second race to bounce back on. But yeah, you're absolutely right. There's 13 more chances to get on the top step of the podium. What's going to hurt for Alexander, or could hurt later in the season, is the consistency of that. Because that fourth position, if he's going to keep that pace up all the way through the year, that fourth position could be the difference between first and second in the championship, Rob.
Yeah, although I think with the field that's still pretty close, you can get away with the fourth position. It would have been worse if he had a complete DNF. His teammate Tocacelli, for example, he had this DNF, and for him that's really not a good start of the season, but it's definitely not over yet. So we should see the first times coming in here. Yep. And it's Klaus Schulze, who set the fastest time with the 127.9.
Yeah, look at that, a 127.9 for the first lap. So he's obviously got something to prove here, straight out of the block, and he's gone faster. But watch out, here's Etienne Bruns. He is definitely on a fast one. He's looking at a tenth of a second quicker than Klaus Schulze has managed. Dorneden has done a 128.027 for his first lap out of the blocks. So that's pretty quick, but what can Bruns do? Is it to the top of the timesheets? Oh, no, it's not. He ends up losing a little bit there, 128.1 to end his qualifying run. So he's going to have to try again, and that's exactly what he's doing. So Bruns needing to get another quick lap in the board. He loses out on pole position by, get this, 0.081 of a second. It is so close at the top there.
Yeah, and it's good to see also that it's a little bit mixed, that it's a little bit different names at the front, because we have Ailcio Jr. from the team RRS, from the Brazilian team, in fourth position at the moment, and we have not seen him up there so far, so it's great to see that he can do fast time as well.
Yeah, that's right, yeah, because he was just outside the top 20 in the first session. He didn't quite hook it all together, but tell you what, he's right there now, as we have Nicholas Laubisch we're looking at now, looking for, well, potentially, look at that, potentially pole position. He's gone 0.081 in the first split. He might be able to get one over on Klaus Schulze here, and if he can get pole position, considering he was 18th in the first qualifying session earlier on, Nicholas Laubisch, oh, look at that, there's nothing in it in this qualifying session, 0.004 of a second. He nails this final sector, he could well see himself starting at the front of the grid, if not, certainly in the top two rows, and that will definitely transform his fortunes.
Yeah, and Nicholas Laubisch, he's a very interesting driver in this league, because I talked to him before the race, and he's actually only 14 years old. He's already
Goodness
competing
me.
With the best drivers here.
That's
so
incredible.
It's very impressive.
14 years old, what can he do 14 years from now? Because some of the drivers in this are in late 20s, of course, and are still very talented. Klaus Schulze, another fast lap, but it's not faster than his best. Look at Etienne Bruns though, second sector, he's 0.2 of a second up. He is determined to get this final lap nailed. He'll be going, come on, come on, as he comes across the line. Has he done it this time? Surely, yes! Look at that, 127.852. That is a big improvement compared to where he was. And that, I think, is the fastest lap, Rob, we've had in terms of the entirety of the sessions. I don't think anybody went quicker than that in the first session.
I think Alexander was also in the 8s, but I'm not quite sure if he beat that time. Definitely it's close, so I think Alexander could set a faster time, but I'm not sure if he still has time for it. And we can see here Garibaldi, he's still on the lap, he will get this time counted, but it's not going to be fast enough. So this is already it for Gargo.
Yeah, I think he's going to have to settle for the fact that fourth is as good as he's going to get.
Look
from
how
this
close
one.
He's going to the pitfall entry there, wow.
Well, maybe he thinks that he can shave a couple of thousandths of a second just by going that close. And he's got fourth position, 0.281. So he has improved just a little bit there, but it's not quite. Now, Davide Tocacelli, he's one who could move up a long way here. He's 0.4 of a second off the pole. He might just have one final chance. That man as well, Jan Stanger, he might have an opportunity to go up into the top six.
I don't think he will get it in. I don't think he will make the snap count, because remember, we are switching directly after the qualifying session.
Oh, of course we are. Yes, good point.
So these times are probably not going to count, and it's very unfortunate. And yeah. What I'm wondering is, when is he going to fuel into his car? So that could be a big problem for Jan Stanger. Hopefully he already was on a full tank when he drove around there, but otherwise he might have a big problem. Anyway, we're ready for the race.
We certainly are. Bruns on the pole position on the left side of the circuit. Schulze is beside him on the other side, and away we go. Good start from Bruns. Is he going to be able to hold off the attentions? Dorneiden is up to third position already. He's made a good jump on Baldi. So Dorneiden up into third position straight away. Schulze is trying to cover to the inside line. We're on board with Bruns as we look back. He's got a flyer of a getaway, and Schulze is going to lose that second position at this rate, with Dorneiden going to try and come through to the inside line. That is a beautiful overtake from Dorneiden. If he can get this one finished off, Schulze is not going to be very nice to hold him on. Baldi's going to get through as well into third position. If he gets a good sweep into the next left-hander, it's going to be difficult, because Schulze is going to try and get that back on the inside to hold on to third position. Two wheels up in the air. That was a big moment, but he was determined to hold on to that third position. Unfortunately, Baldi was already through.
Yeah, great start from Etienne Bruns, actually. He pulled out like 3/10 right off from the line. And then Dorneiden made the best out of his starting position on the racing line, used the extra grip for the start, and then held on around the outside. So a great start for Alex, and he's in a position to attack for a race win again.
And we had a spin, I think, or certainly a run wide further down the order. That's Yannis Baumann, who's lost a lot of ground in the midsection. He's not having the greatest meeting here, is he? He's had a bit of a topsy-turvy day at the office. Yeah. He's had the speed, but he's definitely not had the composure.
Oh, and I think he's got a connection problem, because we can see one of the blue cars. I just think it's him. I'm not entirely sure. We can see it warping around a little bit.
Yeah,
so
it's a bit of a lag there, unfortunately. Yeah. So maybe we might not see too much more of him in this race.
Oh, there's one car off in the background. There's one of the blue cars off. And that's the Euronix driver. That's Etienne Bruns. He's out.
Bruns. Etienne Bruns, the race leader, is out of this second race. Now, that is an absolute nightmare, as Norbert Leitner is into the pits. So too is Etienne Bruns.
Happened there?
Well, it looks to me as though Bruns is out of the race. He's stopping in the pits. Well, that has just thrown a major spanner in the works for this championship. It means we're going to have two different winners from each of the two races, guaranteed. But what we are going to see is, if Bruns doesn't score, well, this is going to mean more than just a loss of points. Well, he's in the pits. Has he been given a penalty? You don't think he was given a jump start there, Rob?
No, you can't get a jump start penalty. You just can't jump the start. So that can't be it. But you could see a blue car standing in the gravel trap on the outside of the final corner. And I've got no idea what happened there, because it didn't look like Dorneiden was really close enough to try and move or so. So honestly, I've got no idea what happened to him, but this is huge.
Yeah, this is huge for the championship. The other man who's right down at the back, actually, is Alcio Jr., who's not had a great race either, considering how strong he was supposed to be from the qualifying. He's down in 29th now, Alcio Jr., so he's had an issue as well somewhere out in the circuit. It's showing him as, where is he? Is that whom we're watching now, the 94? Yes, but he's showing up as down in 29th position, so he's actually being lapped by these guys at the front end of the field. Now, that's a problem. Hang on a minute. Ooh. Alcio Jr., he's a lap down, and he's got the leaders trying to get him out of the way. Come on, Alcio.
I think, to be honest, he missed the sector split, because I can't think of, that he's already a lap down. I can't think of anything that would happen that would put him so far back so early on.
Yeah,
probably it's just the timing that hasn't picked him up properly.
Yes, possibly, I suppose. If that's correct, then maybe we might see him back in the top six again as well. But Dorneiden now, through all of that, we've almost pretty much forgotten the fact that with Bruns down the order and out of the race, effectively, it's now Dorneiden who leads the way from Baldi and Schulze. So it's going to be the other Nemotech racing car that could be on course for a podium here. But incidentally, the other man in the team, or certainly the man who was on the podium last time, Baumgartel, is down in 20 seconds. And that shows again, Rob, just how different one race is to the next and how close it is.
Yeah, and it's been a lot of drivers that were having problems, like Butcher in the first race, as well as Toccacelli. And now Bruns. Whoa! Lucas Rivoni just got sent off the track in the hairpin. What happened there? Just got hit off by the white car.
Well,
I think this was Barreto or Luciani.
I think you're right. It was Carlos Barreto. But yes, Rogerio Rivoni having the worst end of the deal there as the 99 car rejoins the circuit. And the Frenchman, well, he's going to be hopping mad about that one, isn't he? I'm not entirely sure what the excuse is going to be for that one. But he's a racing driver, Carlos Barreto, so I'm sure he's got one. But whether it will stand up in court or not is another thing.
That was a big hit. I mean, he must have carried way too much speed into this corner. It's a corner that you usually drive in second gear, and some driver will probably drive it in third, but that looked more like fifth gear, full speed.
It did. Crazy. It almost looked too Grand Theft Auto to be race room, didn't it, at one point? There you go. Laubisch now. Oh, aggressive. He's in the braking zone. He's able to carry so much more energy into the braking zone than Yanis Baumann. And that's got the German on the back foot. Yanis Baumann trying to hold his line. Nicholas Laubisch, he's starting to get really racy. I thought I could sense that there was a little bit of frustration in race one. Now he's got himself a good grid position here. He is on it.
Yeah, but he has to fight against Laubisch, and Laubisch will be pushing really hard in the beginning of this race. And yeah, it's very interesting. It's good to see these new drivers coming into the league. And like Angano, Baumann and Laubisch, they all have not raced in TPS before, so it's their first race meeting for them. And look where they are, fighting in the top 10, so it's great to see.
Yeah, it's really, really encouraging stuff. Dorneydin leading the way, 2 seconds clear. I should point that out because we haven't really noticed it. 2 seconds ahead of Giorgio Baldi with Schulzer right on his tail. So second position is definitely up for grabs. Chris Butcher, he's having a much better race in fourth position now. About a second clear of Mangano with Baumann in sixth position. In fact, we just saw him go through there. And there is the man in seventh place. Well, there was the man in seventh place. That's Laubisch. Then it's Koshkin, Hack, Leitner, and this man that we're riding on board with Jan Stanger. Although Emil Yanenko trying to come through. Is that Emil Yanenko making the move, Dan? I'm not sure if he's actually managed to get that solid. No, he hasn't. Emil Yanenko has to hang back in position. That was close, Rob.
That was very close, and that was quite optimistic to try to overtake there. But Emil Yanenko is not finished yet. Try again. Dang, in the yellow car, but there's also another red car and a black car, so cars all over the place, and I think Emil Yanenko got the place from Stanger.
Yeah, he did. Stanger, I think he overshot into the first hairpin, so Stanger obviously having a bit of an issue, but now he's going to try and get back his position to the inside line. Meanwhile, the 94 of Koitler is trying to move up just in front, so there is a lot of change and to and fro in the positions. It's very close at the moment. Denis Emil Yanenko looking very racy, and he's definitely got a good opportunity here to get one over on Leitner.
Yeah, now we see back from Pavel Koshkin. To be honest, I'm not quite sure who the red car is in this fight. Is it Koitler or is it Yund?
Well, it's the
There's contact!
That's not gone well. That's Koshkin in the mix there, along with Chris Hack, I think, was involved in that one as well. So,
Laubisch from the battle ahead.
Oh, dear. It Pavel Koshkin. It was Denis Emil Yanenko. So Yanenko was the one who's dropped back. And Yanenko's down to 20th position now. Laubisch is down into 14th position. Lunderman is down into 15th position. So a couple of the drivers really getting stymied by that one. And Laubisch, well, he's going to be very frustrated. He had a difficult race one, and it was looking like it was going to go his way in race two. Perhaps not.
Yeah, apparently he made contact battling with Yanis Baumann, and that cost him a lot of positions. And I think Emil Yanenko was just a victim there in the scene, so definitely not good.
Interestingly, Baumann is still there in position. He's in sixth position, so he may be feeling pretty smug about the fact I got away with that one, and that was pretty close. But up the inside, this is going to be a move for position as Term gets the move on Plunderman just behind Laubisch. So he's up into position, and the third man in the equation there, Robert Platz, he's going to come through as well. Tucks to the outside line. Oh, it's getting very close in the team squabble. Plunderman desperately tries to hang on.
Oh no!
Plunderman has been pinned there by Platz.
That was a close one though, because he was closing the door quite late, but it looked like Platz was a bit late on the brakes and just tapped him, gave him a little tap on the rear.
Maybe just a couple of inches in the braking zone is what made the difference there. And Plunderman, well, he's going to have a lot to say about that one, but it's not going to make any difference to the result. He's down to 23rd position behind Divider and in front of the Canadian Arnold Columbia, so he's lost a huge amount of time. That's not gone well at all. Meanwhile, Alexander Dorneydin, well, he's looking to put right what went wrong in race one. He's there in the lead. 3 seconds clear of our man in second place, Giorgio Baldi, with Schulzer 0.2 of a second back. Butcher's not far away either, actually. So the man in fourth position, Chris Butcher, he's still got a chance of a podium, although he's coming under some pressure from the Italian Giorgio Mangano. Then it's Baumann in sixth position from Koshkin, Hack, Leitner, and Stanger, with Koitler, Yunt, Raivio, Laubisch, Term, and Platz, who we're watching in 15th
and
16th.
And you can see the car from Alexander Term. You could see that it has a big damage at the front, so he's been in some battles as well. Maybe he picked that up with the accident with Laubisch. And this red car there, who is it? I think Koitler.
That is Koitler.
He also has the same damage at the front, and Yunt just drives past him.
Yeah, that is Koitler, who's got some damage, so you can see...
Good race from David Jon, by the way. He didn't start very far up, but like he usually does in the races, he's very solid, very consistent, and he stays out of trouble, and yeah, he's picking up a lot of positions here.
I'm glad you mentioned that, Rob, because it's that kind of consistency, actually, that could buy him the championship at the end of the year. Okay, so the Nürburgring is not in the top six, but that doesn't mean he won't be in the top six for the remaining six rounds of the championship. So the points you gain here could be crucial when we get to the final round of the championship at Hockenheim, because it'll be that 11th position, that 12th position, that could make all the difference. And good work from Jont. You know, he's used a lot of his push-to-passes. He's not got many going into the second half, but he's actually in a pretty strong position. He's only a couple of seconds off the back of Jan Stanger, and there's four cars in front of them battling for position, led by Yanis Baumann with Koshkin, Hack and Leitner in tow. So Jont is actually not in a bad position here at all, being in 11th position with a few push to passes left. He could steal a pretty solid top six finish if he's not careful.
Yeah, David Jont has been my teammate for several years, and I've always said if he just puts a little bit more practice in, he could actually, you know, fight for wins in these leagues. And and see it here in the second race that he's found the pace, and if he could just find that little bit more, he would actually be able to do extremely well in all these championships. But even so, even now, he's looking to pick up a really good points finish.
Well, Koshkin has got Hack and Leitner scrapping away for eighth position behind him. I think Leitner is about to put one over on Chris Hack round the outside if Chris Hack doesn't shut that door pretty firmly. He needs to make that Audi as wide as a Buick at the moment, because Leitner's really, really taking it to him through the slower corners. He seems to have a lot more in terms of energy through the corners. He's using a lot more curve, but he also seems to get good power off the turn. He might have an opportunity.
Oh, Leitner might have a chance.
Yeah, I think you're right. Now he decides to hang back at the moment, but that's going to be a little bit of a wake-up call to Chris Hack. That's a you-hoo, is anybody home moment for Chris Hack, and now it's up to him to keep him at bay. But Leitner is really gunning for it, Rob. He's not done yet.
Yeah, but you can also see that Leitner is being cautious. He's not trying too hard to attack in a corner where he's very low chances of making the move stick. He's an experienced driver. He's someone who already raced with us 5 years ago. And so is Chris Hack. So these two probably know each other and they respect each other on track. And I don't think we will see an accident between them. But it certainly looks like that Leitner has got very good race pace. And the Smile Power Racing driver, I don't think he will necessarily finish in that position. I think he can still move up.
Well, if we're going to make sure that Lightning doesn't strike twice in the same place, we should keep an eye on Dawn Eden out in front. He still has anywhere between a 2.5 and 3 second advantage at the moment on Baldi, but Schulze is right on his tail, so that's not done and dusted. There is Schulze, in fact. It's not 0.2 seconds anymore, is it? It's a couple of millimeters as he now looks round the outside for Giorgio Baldi. Now he's going to try and cut to the outside line. There's no way through. Baldi is not going to give him an inch. Every time he looks to make a move, he covers. But Baldi isn't being aggressive with his defensive tactics, is he? He's being just that beautiful calculation, that balancing point between a full block and just parking the car in the right position on the circuit. He's not too much to the left. He's not too much to the right. He's right in the center of the racing line. So Schulze is going to have to do something pretty special to get one over on the Hungarian. And at the moment, you have to say, Klaus Schulze, no pushes to pass. It's really not looking good.
Yeah, but the regular TPS followers will probably remember the TC1 race at the same track 1.5 weeks ago, where Jago Baldi was leading the entire race, and then on the last lap, Julian Kunze pulled off a great move around the outside of the first corner. So he's doing a good job now, but he has to stay, you know, has to stay awake and stay very, very cautious with Schulze right behind him. And Schulze, what an impressive race from him. He's just, he's looking so quick, putting so much pressure on Baldi, and and certainly looks like he can go a little bit faster at the moment.
Yeah, I have to say, Klaus Schulze are very impressive. They want to keep an eye on their mirrors, though, because both Chris Butcher and Giorgio Mangano are starting to close up on them again, so it looks as though we could eventually have a four-car fight. The lower two steps of the podium, Schulze again has a look as Baldi runs across the apron to block the German in his position of second place. There's Mangano. There was Mangano in fifth position. We were going to look at him briefly, I think. We're on board with Butcher. That's not a lot of gap between himself and third position. He is getting much closer under braking. These two continue to squabble. They're going to back themselves into Butcher and Mangano, and that's going to make things very entertaining at the end of this race. Now it looks as though his shots are going to have a go at Baldi. No, again, he just puts the nose out in front, has a bit of a look at him. He's not going to go anything aggressive. There's still 5.5 minutes or so left on the clock. So I would have made the move in two laps time if I was still on the boot of Giorgio Baldi. little bit hairy though mid-corner though, isn't it, Rob? It's very, very difficult not to lose the back end. It snaps away pretty aggressively through that part of the course.
But just look at Chris Butcher, and this is the most experienced driver in the whole field, and he's still got 5 push to pass left. He's saving that for the end. Oh, and that's Schulze going in a very, very fast corner for the move.
Yeah, he's caught Baldi out.
Is he going to make
he's
it stick?
It
no.
There. He's going to get up the inside. No, he's going to run wide. He's going to have to give that place up. So Baldi gets through. Butcher's going to use the opportunity around the outside. No, very good defensive move there from Schulze.
But look at Butcher. He's now on the push to pass, and I think Schulze doesn't have one anymore. So this should be an easy pass for Butcher. And he's taking the inside. Now, let's see if Schulze can hang around on the outside in the first corner. Still ahead.
Butcher's there on the inside, though. He might be able to get the run around the outside if he can keep the energy of the car dissipated. They bang doors, they bang wheels, and still Schulze holding that inside line. Butcher has to concede and run in fourth position. Mangano's got to close up on both of them as they make this move into the left-hander, down the hill, using the apron to get good purchase into the right-hander. A little bit of curve, but not too much, because it'll spit you out to the outside line. This is really energetic stuff from Chris Butcher as he puts Klaus Schulze. He's now the man under pressure, isn't he, Schulze? Because Baldi, he made a mistake, but he wasn't able to capitalize on it. And that little moment, by the way, Rob, that's seen Alexander Dunedin extend his lead to what is now 3.5 seconds or so. He's got this one on a plate again. The big question is he going to be able to hold it this time?
Yeah, just about the move from Schulze and Butcher. So Schulze was doing a great job defending here. He just held it around the outside and just powered out of the corner, and then he had the inside for the next one. But if I were Chris Butcher, I would have not given Schulze that much room on the exit. So it seems like Butcher is playing it safe as well. But yeah, as you said, for Dunedin, I'm not sure if he really has to be pushing that much at this stage. Maybe he should just try to drive safe, drive a little bit slower, protect his tires and his brakes, and just carry it home so we don't see a repeat. But it's now 4 seconds that he has as a gap. So he must still be pushing.
Yeah, I think he might be, and he may well run into exactly the same problem he had in race one. But this is on board with Baldi. Round the outside, Klaus Schulze is going deep into the braking zone. Can he take it right round the outside, or again, is Baldi going to be solid? Yes, he holds the line beautifully to the inside line. He doesn't give Schulze an inch of space on the inside line. And Giorgio Baldi, again, defending brilliantly here. The Hungarian having an absolutely brilliant race, it has to be said here, Rob. He's really controlling this opportunity he's got with malice and calculation.
Yeah, but this is not a comfortable position to be in, because now it's not only Schulze, but it's also Butcher and Mangano who are just right behind him. And if he just makes the slightest mistakes, he will not only get passed by one car, but by three.
Yeah, he just made a bit of a mistake there, Baldi. He ran a little bit too deep into the hairpin, and that's allowed Schulze to tighten up, that's allowed Butcher to tighten up, and that's allowed Mangano to tighten up as well. 4 cars scrapping away for the lower 2 steps of the podium behind Dunedin. And of course, all 4 of these guys will know what happened to Alexander Dunedin in race one. So they're all thinking, well, what if he does that again? This is not a battle for the second place. This is a battle for victory. I've got to go for it again and hope that I can just stay hungry and stay in the chase. 2 minutes to go. That is the equivalent, Rob, of 2 laps to go.
Yeah, and just look at this queue of cars, and you just couldn't put anything in between. And, that would be really interesting how it turns out in the end, because the time's running out now.
They really are. The brakes are going to be difficult. They're going to be very spongy, particularly in the very slow corners. The tyres are going to be loose. They're going to be pushing the car to the outside without even attempting to. Here goes Schulze. He's going to go deep. Butcher's going to try and go with them. There's a little bit of a clang. Mangano's got a front row seat for all of this to unfold. Schulze's there to the inside line. Butcher's going to try and cut across the apron once again to tuck in for the inside line. Watch him go to the left. No, he's going to stay there in position. Now he's going to have a look, but he's...
Oh, he goes to wide. This could be Mangano's opportunity.
Back of Schulze there. I think they nudge bumpers. Mangano's going to try, and Butcher has to shut the door very quickly indeed there to keep him at bay, but Mangano's still got plenty of speed and plenty of space. He might have an opportunity around the outside if Butcher can't hold it. Good control there from Chris Butcher. That is saving your bacon and no mistake. He could well have bought himself a podium just by keeping Mangano at bay through that hairpin.
I thought he already lost it in the Mercedes Arena by going too wide there, but you could see that Schulze was also going wide. I don't think there was contact, but they were just both trying to brake as late as possible. They're having a little bit of brake problems as well, and Butcher just held on to Mangano, and you can see how close Mangano is again, so this is not over for Butcher yet.
Well, there's Dunedin, who's about to go into a similar situation to what he was in race one. He had the lead. It was comfortable. It was half what it is now, admittedly, but it was a comfortable lead and it was his race to lose. Now for Alex Dunedin, he needs to hang on to this advantage. He's only got a fourth position from race one when he led every lap. This time...
Oh, Mangano's past Butcher. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Yes, he has. You're absolutely right. They're side by side. Mangano's to the wall and Butcher's to the outside line. Is Mangano going to be able to hold this on the run to the braking zone? Butcher's going to try and exacerbate that energy to the outside. He's not giving Mangano much room on the inside and he's held him off. That's
nice
brilliant.
From Butcher. That was nice.
Brilliant defending work there from Butcher. He has completely shown Mangano a clean pair of heels. And again, up on two wheels goes Mangano in his attempts to close up on Butcher. That means, though, that both of them have fallen off the back of Baldy and Schotzer. So it looks as though those two are going to be fighting for the podium. Butcher again up on two wheels. Mangano gives him a little love tap. Come on, mate, get on with it.
You can see how late he's on the brakes, and I thought maybe Mangano would try to dive on the inside because Butcher was leaving the door open, but didn't go for it yet. So he's running out of opportunities now. This is the last lap. He has to make it work as soon as possible if he wants to get the fourth position.
Well, Schotzer is right on the back of Baldy. Mangano's right on the back of Butcher. It looks as though things could change rather dramatically. But this man out in front, he is not going to let history repeat itself. Lightning will not strike twice in the same place. Alex Dunedin dominated race one for all but the last lap. This time he's going to put it right in race two. Fourth in race one, victorious in race two. Fantastic result for Alex Dunedin, and that is more like it. He swerves with celebration. Brilliant race win for Dunedin. Baldy is going to pip Schotzer to the line, as too is Butcher in front of Mangano, but only just. It's going to be Norbert Leitner who comes home in sixth position, unless Hack can get one over on him on the final couple of corners. But Leitner is going to get there in front of Hack, and who's going to get to eighth position? Will it be Koshkin or will it be Stanger? It is going to be Koshkin just in front of Stanger with Victor Koitler, the Brazilian, in 10th position in front of David Yunt. So 11th place, that's solidly enough, I suppose. Then we have, up to 10th position across the line. Well, maybe he overtook after the finish line, I'm not sure. But in there was the Finn, I think that is, of Jonas Raivio. I'm not sure if he actually crossed the line in 10th position or if he was a little bit late to the party. But look at that, Etienne Bruns, 22nd position. He finishes the race, so he scores points. But that's a big hammer blow to his championship attack after winning race one, Rob.
Yeah, and I just had a look in between the races, and there's actually a drop score. So you will drop your two worst race results. So not from the whole event, but from every single heat. So your two worst heats will get dropped. So, he can probably still recover from that. But at the same time, of course, this is, I don't know what happened there on the first lap, but this was looking really strange because he was leading comfortably on the first lap, and then all of a sudden he was in the gravel and going through the pit lane.
Well, the man who finished the race in 10th position was also the man who got the fastest lap in. Jonas Raivio did finish in 10th position. He did manage to beat Koitler to 10th position and push David Yunt down to 12th place on the last lap with Laubisch in 13th. So Jonas Raivio got the fastest lap on the very last lap of the race by the look of it. But wow, what a start to the season then. Etienne Bruns got a win. So too did Alexander Dunedin. And we still don't really have one clear person who's dominating out in front. Because even now we know, Rob, that, okay, Dorneden's pace has been pretty strong. But now we even know he's vulnerable.
Yeah, and I think Garibaldi is leading the championship with 2 second places and a very, very consistent performance. He maybe didn't quite have the pace this time, but he was just driving so clean and just not making a mistake while being under pressure the whole time.
Well, Robert Wiesenmüller, I have to say a huge thank you to you for sitting beside me. It's been a bit nerve-wracking, I have to say, working in such a fantastic environment. It's always been incredibly close, TC2, and I'm really excited about how things have been. So I guess now we're up to the point where we're talking to drivers because we need to figure out exactly how they saw everything that played out. And it's been pretty exceptional considering how hard they've worked. I mean, it's been absolutely incredible.
Yeah, and there are quite a few drivers that I would like to have a word with. Unfortunately, not everyone is here yet.
There's at least 14 of the drivers from that race that I want to talk to because we saw so much action from so many different people.
We will actually take a small break and give these drivers a little bit more time to come into the channel, and then we will be back with the interviews.
Yeah, that's a very good idea. So we'll be back very shortly. Welcome back then to the TC2 Audi Sport TT Cup on Touring Pro Series. What a fantastic opening meeting of the season. It's been really exciting to see two very different races, Etienne Bruns and Alex Dunedin taking the victories. Myself, Jake Sanson and Rob Wiesenmüller, we're going to talk to the drivers who made that weekend so special, that two fantastic races. We'll start, first of all, with the winner of race two. That is Alexander Dunedin. Guten Abend, Alex.
Guten Abend.
So, talk us through those two races. I mean, that must have been really difficult, particularly in race one, when you knew you had the pace all the way through, and it just kind of fell away to the end. Talk us through what happened.
I had a brake failure in the last two laps. That was, I didn't have it at the practice, and suddenly my brakes were a bit gone. Yeah, and then I had to pass Baldi, Etienne, and Max.
That must have been a really difficult end to the race, especially when you'd been leading the whole way and you'd coped with all the pressure Etienne had given you. But you were very strong in making a comeback in race two. You weren't going to let that one get away.
Yeah, it was good for me in the second race. I think Etienne had an issue with the fuel. Yeah, and then the race was easy for me. Could manage a gap for, like, I think, 3 or 4 seconds. Yeah, I had also a gap in the first race, and it was a bit stupid because I pushed too hard. I had to manage the brakes, but it was a dumb fault for me. Yeah.
Well, of course, now that you've got a fourth position and a win, that gets you into a very strong position heading to round two. So what's going to be the tactics moving to the second round for you?
Just win. Drive fast. Yeah, we will see. It's a strong field here.
I'm guessing as well, looking in your rearview mirrors, there's an incredible array of drivers who you must be fearing could well put one over on you.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, well, we hope that obviously moving to the second round, Alex, the pace is still there. So I'm guessing it's back to the training ground for you to make sure everything is ready for the 2 weeks' time.
Yeah, right.
Thank you, Sean, Alex, and congratulations for race two. Well done.
Thank you.
So, Rob, I guess we have many more drivers to talk to. Who's up next?
Yeah, I'm joined by Max Baumgartel here, and he took a podium in the first race of the season. So, Max, how does that feel?
Yes, the first race was great, and I think I have luck with Alex Taylor in the break, and for over the race, I push very hard to catch Baldi with my team colleague, Lau Schulze, but don't became him. However, to the last corner, I catch Alex and I was third.
So, certainly a great start of the season, but then in the second race, you couldn't quite make the same impact and we didn't really see what happened to you, so maybe you can explain to us.
Yes, I drive the back straight and do the chicane and we drive to too wide, but for the corner I was in the middle. I was the insert line, and I was, and the third person was back of me, and I became a push from the back, and I pushed me out, and the race was done. After this, I fight again back, but I think I have a failure with the zero.
Okay, zero. So like a lag problem.
Yes, I don't know what place I have or something. But the second race was frustration for me.
All right, so moving on to the next round. What do you expect for this championship now? Because you're in a very decent position in the points. Do you think you can keep fighting for podiums? Yeah.
Yes, I think so. I think so. This track was not my best, and I hope for the next races I'm stronger and I fight to the podiums, maybe for the victory.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, Max. And
yes, bye.
Now it's Jake's turn again.
Yes, indeed, Rob. We've got one of the British boys who's been providing us with an awful lot of the action in those two races, Chris Butcher. Chris, what a fantastic start of the season from your point of view. Or was it?
Well, it was a bit mixed, really. The first race was it was a bit of a disaster, really. I think I ended up finishing in 19th. But yeah, the second race wasn't too bad. Fourth place after a fairly poor start. I don't think I can complain at that, really.
So obviously, when everything is so close in the first weekend of the championship, you must be thinking about, you know, what you need to do to find that little bit of an edge that Alex had this weekend. 2 weeks time, obviously, you've got to find that little bit more. Where do you think you're going to be able to find that?
Well, I've never really run that well at Nürburgring or Zandvoort, the next track, to be honest with you. So I'm not holding out much hope for that one either. But I think pace-wise, I wasn't too far away. The two or the three main things for me is getting the starts right, finding an extra tenth or two in qualifying, and then tyre management really through that second race is what my main issue was.
And obviously, this is a tough place to start the season as well, because it's such a technical track. You really have to be completely flawless in every single corner in a qualifying lap to give you a good chance of anything.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, even losing two tens, I mean, it puts you in the midfield, and then that can destroy your race, as is what happened with me in the first race, really. I got put off a couple of times, and then it's just an uphill battle from there, really.
So I'm guessing your focus now is to make sure that when we go to Zandvoort, you know, you need to make sure that the elbows are out and the sleeves are rolled up, because it's getting a very physical grid out there. It's really tough to hold your own.
Yeah, it's going to be, and I think that's inevitable when you've got such a fantastic prize on offer. For me now, I've really, to stand any chance, I've got to win every single race now, because I'll be missing the last two races, so that's where my drop scores are going to go, and scoring, I think, 2 points in the first race isn't really good enough.
Okay, well, unfortunate for you for race one, Chris. Good to see you were a factor in race two, and hopefully we'll see you towards the front at Zandvoort. Have a good one.
Thank you.
Okay, so Rob, I think we've got one of the other podium finishers next up.
Yeah, I should have Klaus Schulze here. And Klaus, what a great second race from you. But it just looked like you just couldn't get past Gergo, so talk us through it.
Yeah, race two was quite good. I didn't start that good, but there was where Baldi overtook me and Alex in the first corner. And the whole rest of the race I was fighting with Baldi. I couldn't manage to get past him. We had a lot of fights, hard fights, but good fights, and didn't manage to get past.
All right, so the second race was great, but the first race, you didn't quite get the same result, so maybe you can also tell us what happened there.
Yeah, and the first race had the same problem, that I skipped behind Baldi. And at the end of the race, my teammate was very close to me, so I let him go because he had more push-to-pass rest, that he can overtook Baldi, and in the last corner, I didn't catch Alex, unfortunately. I tried, but didn't happen.
Nonetheless, you are definitely one of the most consistent finishers of this event, and you're sitting really strong in the Drivers' Championship, but also in the Teams' Championship. So what are your goals for this season?
Took as many good points as possible, and look how it comes out at the end.
All right, then thanks, Klaus. And Jake should have a final driver for the interview.
Certainly do. Yes, it's the other Brit in the equation, Chris Hack. Chris, how was that in terms of the energy of the race? It looked pretty hectic out there.
It was definitely hectic. I've got no idea how I ended up where I was. I felt a bit like Moses at times.
I've never heard a racing driver quite describe it like that before. That's an interesting way of looking at it. I mean, both races were very, very different in terms of pace for you, in terms of the dynamic of it, in terms of the way the race ebbed and flowed. It must have been very difficult to handle such different conditions.
I didn't feel too much different, to be honest. In both races, people got together and I suddenly found myself about five positions higher than I started. So I was just trying to stay out of the way of more carnage and get some points, because I came in very, very underprepared for this. It was about a minute before we were working out how much fuel we should be running, so lazy.
Okay, lazy is one way of looking at it. I suppose you go to Zandvoort now knowing exactly what to expect in terms of the field. You know a little bit more now about who is going to be close to you, who's going to have it in for you almost in terms of trying to get one over on you. So what is the strategy going to Zandvoort now? I'm guessing it's going to be, you know, whatever opportunity, you're back in the rig.
Yeah, definitely. More prepared. Really didn't realise this was this week until Monday night. So 2 weeks, get up to speed, spend a bit of time in the cars, and hopefully we'll come back better.
That's not bad considering you only found out about it on Monday. That's pretty impressive. I mean, especially as well, you know, considering you were right in the gaggle for both of those races and you were scratching at the surface of the top 10. So perhaps with more opportunities to prepare, we should be seeing you on a few podiums.
Maybe. But the guys at the front looked really good, so there's definitely a way to go, but we might get there.
Okay, Chris, well, thanks for talking to us and thanks for entertaining us so brilliantly out on track. Thank you.
Cheers.
Well, there you are. What an absolutely incredible first meeting of the 2016 TC2 Audi Sport TT Cup. It's been absolutely incredible watching two brilliant races, Rob, and I think you'll agree with me. We genuinely still don't really know who's going to walk away with this crown. We know who's been the one to take the most advantage out of the Nürburgring, but there's still so long to go and there's so many variables yet to consider.
Yeah, and it looks really interesting because we have on the one side Alexander and Etienne, who were both looking really quick, but both also had had problems in their races. And on the other hand, we had Gerhard Gobaldi and Klaus Schulze as well, for example, who were just driving so consistent and just picked up the points the whole time. And I'm pretty sure drivers like Butcher and so on, they can close this gap and they can win races as well in the future. So it will be really interesting to see how it goes on.
Well, an absolutely brilliant start to the season then. My huge thanks, Rob, for joining me in the commentary box. It's been absolutely brilliant this first weekend. And I know we've got a lot more to come from the next 6 weekends. Thank you, Rob.
Yeah, thank you as well. Really enjoyed it. I hope everyone sitting at home enjoyed this show. Well, it was certainly really close racing, and it will keep going like this. I'm certain on Sandford it will be as close again.
Did I pass the audition, Rob? Do you think is that all right? I mean, how do you think I settle into Touring Pro Series? I don't know if my style works or not.
Yeah, I think that's it's very good.
It's a little way to go.
No. I mean, it's always I haven't commentated in a while, to be honest. And for me, it's also I was a bit nervous going into it, being back here on the commentary. But when you have racing like this, you can't really do that much wrong, right? So the racing speaks for itself. It's just amazing. And I think even if I stay on mute for a whole race, people are still going to enjoy that when they have battling like this. So yeah, I really enjoyed it. And I can't wait for the next race in 2 weeks.
Me neither. Yeah, 2 weeks time we go to Zandvoort in Holland. Same time, same place, 2 weeks from now. You can keep up, of course, with everything that's going on Touring Pro Series via Facebook and via Twitter at Touring_Pro. There's so much going on the Touring Pro Series community as well. So do keep up with that as well. And of course, stay right with us here 2 weeks from now for more action from Zandvoort before our calendar goes through to Hungaroring, to the Saxon Ring, to Spielberg, the Red Bull Ring, as it were, to Norris Ring and the Formula One venue Hockenheim on the 7th of September. This is going to be a cracking summer for some brilliant racing with an Audi Sport experience at the end of it all for our champion. And at this point, we still don't know who that's going to be. From Rob Wiesenmüller and from myself, Jake Sanson, a huge thank you for watching. And we'll see you next time here in the Audi Sport TT Cup from Touring Pro Series. Bye for now.